May I request all of you to please put your hands together as we welcome on stage Dr. Wurster.
I just came back from the MWC in Barcelona with a couple of impressions. I also have at the end of my presentation a short one of the latest technologies and sort of twists around IoT which is happening. It's basically the combination of IoT and artificial learning or AI, which we found very interesting. Just to give you a sort of heads up what happened at the MWC in Barcelona, and I've been there for many, many years. It's very interesting because MWC stands for Mobile World Congress, and it has been going on, as I said, for at least 15 to 20 years. Interesting enough, this year it was all around IoT. It was not about mobile any longer, because in most of the countries, the connectivity, the network, and the storage is there, and so it is not a matter of basically getting these things right. It does vary, of course, from continent to continent, from country to country. It's way more about the applications. So let's kick my short presentation off. First of all, I want to give you a short heads up what Unlimit is. Unlimit was founded last year, officially mid-November, and the idea behind Unlimit is that the Reliance Group basically sat together and they said, okay, there is a huge opportunity coming up in the IoT space, no matter what that means. I'll come to that a bit later. And we want to be part of it. And since, you know, these big companies are not as versatile and agile as startups, the idea behind Unlimit is that we are a standalone business unit. But we can, of course, tap into the resources, the knowledge, and, of course, the financial muscle of the Reliance Group. And it happens all across the world and all across, especially Europe and the US, that large companies are sort of having their spin-offs, their startups, in order to make sure that they can keep up, because this market is very, very dynamic. And complacency is definitely something which you can't afford. Okay. Let's have a look at IoT. What is IoT? And I've got basically two sort of explanations for you. So IoT in pictograms would be that everybody is talking about an unprecedented opportunity and big numbers are coming up, and I will talk about that a little bit later. It's about turn information into action, which is actually way more difficult than one thinks. Because you get a lot of unstructured information. Has anybody an idea, for instance, when we talk about autonomous car, how many data points these little radars are basically storing in a second or in a minute? Do you have any idea? Yeah, it's big. 1 million a second. Yeah. Which means that you need a lot of storage. And so everybody is of course, it's difficult because you have this unstructured information, and then it's about the signal and the noise. There is a lot of noise, meaning there is a lot of data which you don't need, but there are a couple of indications which are be watched at. And that's actually the trick. It's of course insights from analytics, which is very difficult. And it's of course connecting devices. And with devices, you can basically connect, you know, everything more or less. On a more formal analysis, this is now, I've pulled it off from Deutsche Bank. They basically said Internet of Things is a big idea, but promise and reality are distance apart. And I would definitely agree, and this basically applies all over the world. At the moment, there is this big push towards IoT, and it will pay off. At the moment, everybody is talking about, of course, you know, the sort of very highly sophisticated applications, which is a connected car. Does anybody know how many sensors a normal car has today? A standard car, roughly? What do you think? 10, 20, 30? Just give me a sort of 150, roughly. a Formula One car? 300 to 400. And that's basically, you know, where the connection comes into play. And of course, a lot of these automakers, I come to that a little bit later, are very interested in sort of connecting these devices and find out, you know, what's going on. IoT is a set of multi-year secular growth themes in our view, impacting every play in our universe. I think what they mean by this sentence is that IoT serves at the moment as a bracket for everything around digitalization. So, for some people, IoT is a SIM-based business where you have a SIM card plugged, for instance, plugged into your car and via GPS, you know where your car is. For other, it's in, as we call it, within the four walls, that it's about automation. And the third one is, and I just talked about two business-to-business applications, would be, you know, a Fitbit. You could also say, if you have an intelligent device with your with a mobile phone, this could be also IoT. So it serves at the moment, and that's actually something which is happening very often. If an industry or a trend is in its nascent state, that at the end of the day, people are sort of, you know, plugging everything onto these sort of words, and we will see that at some stage this will abate. It will take some time though, but it's exciting, of course. And IoT has the potential for unlocking trillions of dollars of value, and every study I have seen so far, the numbers are huge. They do vary a hell of a lot from country to country. The reason being that, for instance, in Europe and in the US, labor is very, very expensive. And so, of course, if you can shave off two or three people, you know, you save a hell of a lot. Whereas, of course, in India and other parts, you know, saving on labor is not so much the issue, right? I talked to Huawei at the MWC, and we talked about their data center. They are running 50,000 servers with 2.5 people. Yeah, and the rest is just—it's amazing. I couldn't believe it, and I have to verify this number again. But they said we have a huge data center, 50,000 servers in it. And we run the maintenance with 2.5 people, and the rest is completely automated, which I find pretty amazing, if the number is right, and I do believe them. So, to sum it up, yes, there is a huge chance. The chances will play out differently. It's a bit like RFID. I don't know if anybody is into RFID, but the huge killer application for RFID was, in the end, the tracking of clothes, and everybody thought about it as something else in the beginning. This is a sort of roadmap to a connected world, and one should actually read it basically from the bottom to the top. So on one end you have component technologies. It could be location, it could be sensors, interfaces, the setup, robotics and vehicles. Then you have the system design, which is the networking, the architecture, the data management, and of course security. And on top of that you have applications, from small cities up to transportation and hospitals. And of course, it's about cost saving, it's about efficiency, it's about fun and wellness for the consumer, if you think about the Fitbit apps. It's about preventive maintenance. The idea behind preventive maintenance is that at some stage when you drive with your car and for some reason the oil temperature goes unexpectedly high over a certain threshold, you get a message either on your in your car or via your smartphone that you should basically you know, go to the next dealership, which I think is extremely important. Not that you go to the dealership, but it's, I think, extremely important for the automakers, because they don't, at least in a lot of countries, they don't make that much money on the car any longer. It's about the maintenance, right? And so basically they sell the car, and then it's all about, you know, getting the maintenance costs, or getting the maintenance turnover clocked in. And it's also about new income streams, yeah? Because if you do have the transparency, if you do know who is using it, you know, usage-based nearly naturally falls into place. If this is, if I pay for this tool, let's say, I just pick a number, 1,000 rupees, and I have a technology to identify that I'm sitting on this stool with an RFID chip or whatever technology, then I can also say, okay, for every sort of sit you take, you pay X, Y, Z, and that's actually happening a hell of a lot, that it's way more about usage-based rather than, you know, having paying the asset up front, especially, of course, you know, with assets which are way more expensive than a stool. So usage-based will be definitely a business model. And then, of course, you have the potential IoT markets, and they will, of course, work out differently from connected car to transport and logistics. Industrial automation, I'm now from Germany, is huge in Germany. Why? Because we are one country where industrial automation plays a huge, huge part. Labor costs are extremely high, so what you do is you try to basically streamline your operations all over the place. Yeah. Connected home is definitely a use case. The connected consumer, smart meters, and it ranges up to healthcare. We think that healthcare, for instance, will be a huge issue across the world, also in India. Why? Because healthcare costs are rising all over the planet, and if you look at certain hospitals, they are clogged up with patients who want to see a doctor for something which you could also, you know, do via the internet, for instance, to free, you know, more space and more capacity. We do think that healthcare is definitely a place to look at. And of course, then the usual suspects come into place, like the connected car and, of course, logistics. Yeah. Actually, we don't think that there will be smart cities, but a smart city project is highly, highly complex, as we see across the world. And so we think that, I mean, every government is extremely interested in smart city projects. And if you look at the Middle East, Dubai wants to be the sort of smartest city by 2020, but it is a difficult undertaking. I'll give you another example of healthcare. So for instance, what a lot of healthcare companies do, they give the patients, since diabetes is a huge issue all across the world, so what they do is they give the patients a band, they give them an app, and they can then sort of take their blood and the band then sort of measures, you know, the blood sugar, about the how the level of the blood sugar is, and this is then transferred. It's a sort of device of which you put onto your fingers, for instance, and then it's directly transferred to the clinic or to the doctor, and then you can sort of advise them what to do. And this will be cases we see all over the place. Plus, one also has to define that there are different industries, and the different industries, that's what we want to say with this curve, they're on different stages. So, for instance, energy, at the moment, the use of digital is pretty limited for some reason, although there are use cases, but they are not sort of highly integrated. For instance, you know, in the monsoon region, when the monsoon season is on, a lot of transformers blow off. So what you can do is you can, of course, put a sensor in. It has to be very robust, and you have to get the threshold right. That, you know, if something sort of, yeah, if the temperature is not right, that you can switch it off basically when, you know, the threshold has been reached. And of course, logistics is a huge issue. Yeah. For instance, at the airport of Frankfurt, every parcel is now tagged, and it goes so far that there is a sort of pain. It's a huge pain. It's hard to explain. And this pain basically reads what's inside the truck, and then it decides if you have to go to customs or not. And if you go to customs, the form is already pre-filled. So they take it that far. Yeah. Of course, automotive is a huge issue. Why? Because, I mean, the automakers are extremely interested to see what's going on. A big driver in the automotive industry is Tesla. They have connected all their cars, and it's pretty amazing what they can do. In Germany, actually, I think it was two or three weeks ago, a new BMW was stolen, and they basically locked the car with the thief electronically. So that's how far that they take it. And then, of course, the telco and the fintech market is heavily, heavily disrupted by new business models, especially in the States, also in Europe. When you think about when you think about search engines, when you think about artificial intelligence, robo advising is a big hit in Germany, for instance. So you don't go to your financial advisor any longer. You basically sort out your profile, how your risk appetite is, and in what sort of asset class you want to invest, and it works actually pretty well. Which means, on the other hand, that you don't need advisor over the counter any longer, or less advisors over the counter. So it has, and nobody talks about it that much, but of course, the whole IoT movement and the trend towards IoT has a huge impact on unemployment, of course. I mean, when we talk about, the cashless supermarket, and Amazon has one of these supermarkets where I come from in Düsseldorf as a prototype. Well, we talk about, that you don't need, 15 or 20 cashiers any longer, but only two or three which sort of supervise it. When we talk about autonomous driving, what do we do with all the taxi drivers at the end of the day, or with the truck drivers? Yeah. So there is a huge impact on employment, and of course this will be offset to a certain extent by people which are newly employed into the technology, but it's difficult to re-educate a truck driver to a computer science. Yeah, the probability is not very high, and this will at the end of the day be a big problem for every country. There's a very good book I can recommend from two MIT researchers. It's called, very very easy title, The Second Machine Age. One guy is called McAfee, so that's pretty simple because that's one of the virus programs we all use. The Second Machine Age, and it's very, very interesting, so it's a good read. Good. Okay, here again we see the readiness index. Yeah, we see that actually I would agree that the government or that the governance and the competence, that they are actually readier than other parameters. You see it especially with your government at the moment. I mean, at least from what I gather, is what the Modi administration has definitely realized, and they are pressing for that very, very hard. And I have to say, I do admire it. If you think about the digitization, or the demonetization, I think it was a very bold move in November last year, to do that. And it's debatable how it worked, but I find these comparisons in between, for instance, Trump and the Brexiteers and Modi, completely wrong, because he didn't lie. And plus, I think in the long run, your country will benefit from that. And the rationale behind is clear. According to all statistics, the percentage of people who pay tax is in between 1% and 3%. So, I mean, it's obvious what he wants. He wants to get more taxes, more income, to get the infrastructure up and running. Your infrastructure has increased 6 times over the last 10 years, but your roads, you see today, and I always come late, and your roads and your whole infrastructure doesn't keep up with that, and you need money for that. And I think that was, for instance, a very good move. In Germany, I just read they want to invest 100 billion euros, for faster internet access. And our internet is already very fast, to go to LTE, to 5G. So every country, sort of the governments, are pressing for that, because they have realized if they don't do that, the competitiveness of the overall country or the continent will definitely drop. So coming to numbers, that's from Machina Research. This is one of the most sort of serious research research institute we know of. You see, I mean, if you think about the connections, we go from, they increase basically nearly fivefold, from 6 to 27 billion. The cellular connections from 330 million up to 2.2 billion. Today, India is the second largest smartphone market in the world. Yeah? And at some stage, it will be the biggest smartphone market in the world. Total revenue, yeah, it's debatable. Yeah, I mean, it's difficult for me to imagine $750 billion. Yeah? And the generated data, which I find actually always sort of funny that people are talking about the generated data, because storage is not a problem any longer. You know, storage is not an issue. Storage, it's easy to store, and storage is cheap. And that's actually also one reason behind the overall IoT trend and the push for IoT, that storage is so cheap. In India, and the opportunity is also big. Why? Because at the end of the day, of course, IoT is just about to take off, and there are already applications, especially in asset tracking and other fields. But you know, you are the biggest, the largest democracy in the world. In a couple of years, you will overtake China. Your government and your institutions are poised to leapfrog, because they have realized that that you want to catch up, that's the only sort of possibility to catch up with the developed world. And you have a huge advantage over other nations. The Indians are very entrepreneurial, and your population is very young. So I do see, you know, a lot of opportunities for India in this push towards IoT. Yes, you see, I mean, we can talk about the numbers, but you're definitely the youngest startup nation in the world, and we at Unlimit, we have just started an IoT contest called Interthrone that was like 2 or 3 months ago, and we had like 400 entries in a couple of weeks, which was pretty stunning. And it does speak, you know, for the entrepreneurial spirit of the Indians. We also have a lot of connections to companies which, you know, are tied towards Silicon Valley and all these innovation hubs. And a lot of Indians are so patriotic that they support their home country. So I do see a lot of opportunity for India. I already talked about that. I think at the end of the day, IoT in India will take off, because the government is poised to do as much as they can. Yeah. Not all of us like it, of course, yeah, but I'm also not to pay TM. Yeah. In Germany, I still pay cash. Why? Because we are a cash-based society, and it's not an issue. You are entrepreneurial, and you also have a good industrial base. So now the ingredients are definitely there. So coming to the topic of my speech, it's not about to embrace IoT. I think it's about really committing yourself to IoT, because if you don't embrace it, at the end of the day, you will be left behind. And I can't tell you what will be the killer application or the use case which will sort of, you know, be the most successful in India or across the world, because at the moment there is a lot going on. But if you don't embrace it at the end of the day, and if you don't commit yourself, your company, your employees towards it, it's going to be very difficult. Now there are two use cases I want to show to you. For instance, this one is, there are many, it's a classical OBD dongle which you put into your OBD unit in the car. And what it does, it can detect aggressive acceleration and braking, how fast the car is driven, when the car is driven, where the vehicle is driven, and also crash detection. That's the use case, usage-based insurance, which we thought would work in India, but it doesn't work in India. The reason being, first of all, you won't get reimbursed by your insurance for 3 or 4 years. That's what we learned at the end of the day. And so this is a use case which wouldn't work. It works in other countries in the world, and maybe in a couple of years it will work in India, but that's something, you know, we take with our thinking to your country, but then, you know, we have to adapt it, because that's not how it works. What would work or what will work is an asset tracker. It could be an OBD dongle which connects to 2G, 3G, you name it, and you just can see, you know, where the car is driving, if the driver is sort of on route or off route. And this is a very good start. I mean, when we went to MWC, do you know what we did on our booth? We had a rickshaw there, an original rickshaw from Mumbai. Yeah, we had to take the motor off. Otherwise, we wouldn't have been allowed to bring it over. Why? Because we learned that from 2020, all the rickshaws have to have an emergency button, and the government also wants them to be tracked, apparently. And if the rickshaw driver hasn't installed it, what's going to happen is that there won't be, that the registration won't be renewed. And I think these are the sort of use cases which make a lot of sense in the beginning. Also, there are a couple of usage-based insurance use cases now happening across the world. You will see how it works out. It's definitely a good means for the insurance to find out, you know, how is the driver doing. And at the end of the day, it's actually just learning even more about your customer, what's going on. I don't know if you know this famous example. There was one example featured in a couple of months in a paper. So basically, Walmart sent it, baby clothes and baby gear and nappies and all the rest of it to a household. And the father was wondering at the mother, and they said, you know, it's really strange, you know, why is this happening? And so they learned that basically their kid bought a couple of things which are related to birth. Walmart sort of analyzed it in their big data. They sent off all this promotional material. She didn't know that she was pregnant, but when she went to the doctor, she found that she was pregnant. So that's basically how far it goes in the US. Yeah. And so, yes, security will be an issue, but what will be actually a huge issue is customer integrity. How do you make sure that the companies don't know everything about you? And that's something the industry must address. Otherwise, a lot of customers will just say, look, I'd rather pay a premium, but then, you know, but that's the price I pay, that you don't know any data, that you don't know all the data of myself. Another use case is, of course, fleet management solutions. I think this makes a lot of sense in India to check, you know, where is your fleet going? What about the fuel? Yeah, where are the things unloading, offloaded? That's, and it's already happening. Yeah, we know of a lot of companies who are basically, which are basically, now tracking or tagging their fleet. So I would say this is definitely a use case which works, and it works all over the world. So sometimes it's not the most sophisticated use cases. It's a use case which sounds pretty sort of simple, but once the management has the data, you know, they're very keen to get more data, and that's actually how it works out. So it's more on an evolutionary path rather than, you know, a very sophisticated device in the first place. Okay, and we are now on the www.coney page. I agree. Then we go to real-time conversation. That's basically what we saw in our video. And if you want to listen live, for instance, to Côte d'Azur in France, we go to listen live. This is the real-time
looking for passengers in France.
I confirm idle status.
And these are the conversation highlights.
Perfect leveling on floor 1.
Good job.
Doors reopen 3 times.
Thanks, I copied 3 reopenings.
Up, accelerating at 0.78 meters per second squared.
Adding that to my analysis.
So that's basically how far it goes at the moment, which I think is pretty far. to be honest with you. Yeah, so that was basically it. I hope you enjoyed my speech. If you have any questions, I'm very welcome to answer them. And thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much. And if you do have any questions, we request you to please raise your hands. We bring the microphones to you, and we can have them answered right here.
Yes.
Hi, good morning.
Morning.
My question is related to that slide where you spoke about the readiness.
Mm-hmm.
I believe that is about the readiness of India as a country in IoT space. Is that mm-hmm. correct?
Yes.
Okay. How did you do that? What was the source of information and data?
We had a couple of surveys running on the readiness index. Yeah, of course it's debatable, but I mean we just wanted to know, you know, how ready are the different sort of parameters. And sometimes, you know, readiness, the word readiness has something, implies something that it's free. Sometimes, basically, through demodernization, we were forced to be ready. You know what I mean? So, these are the external forces on that. Any other questions? Yes?
Yeah, so of all the industries that you mentioned, right, healthcare, logistics, automobile, which industry do you think will generate the maximum IoT revenue?
Maximum? It's a good question. I would say it will be automotive because they have just so much money at the end of the day, and they are so driven now with the latest technologies, you know, electrical cars, and it's also a very homogeneous sort of industry which face, you know, more or less the same problems. So I would say it will be automotive. That's also actually one of the most difficult use cases, a connected car. And the second one, if you look on a global scale, I would say healthcare and logistics. Healthcare is huge, logistics is huge, and automatization, depending on how much production there is in the country. There's of course a lot of production in Germany, but not that much in France, for instance, or in Italy any longer. Yes?
Hello, good morning.
Morning.
My question is regarding IoT versus employment, because that is going to be creating a lot of problem as far as India is concerned. Already we are facing a lot of employment issues in India, and maybe US as well, what I can see looking at the today's scenario.
Mm-hmm.
So what's the plan? Because I do take example of Foxconn, wherein in China they were having, you know, 100,000 employees, where what they did, they replaced 50,000 employees with robots. So why, is there any alternate to, you know, overcome this employment issue as technology is going to grow? So what's the plan actually for this?
Honestly, I can't tell you what the plan is. There is another book which I would recommend. It was the Business Book of the Year, recommended by McKinsey. It's called The Rise of the Robots. And I think that every nation will face huge problems, to be honest with you. I do think that, for instance, India is still in a very good position because you have a very young population, you are very entrepreneurial, and plus you're also, you know, a technology-driven country. If you look at the States, if you look, you know, at the Rust Belt, and what's happening with these people over there, it's understandable, you know, that they vote differently. But this will be an issue, and the issue will be, in my case, especially the transition phase. We talked about autonomous driving and cashless supermarkets. What do you do with these people who are, let's say, 50, and they still haven't earned enough? They still need another 15 years to make a living, and they are replaced by a cashless sort of device, you name it. and will be difficult to reskill them, right? It is a huge issue. And at the moment, everybody is very sort of optimistic about digitalization, and it brings a lot of benefit for them which are in the game, but it's going to be difficult for others which are not. I have no question. I have no answer to that. But it could well be that this will be a huge, one of the biggest problems every nation has to go about. In the upcoming years, it depends how fast actually, artificial intelligence is sort of driving. And the most important takeaway for me was reading through these books that actually also when we think about digitalization, we think about the worker, we think about the guy who is basically working on the street. But what's happening now with artificial intelligence is that even jobs like accountings, like chartered accountants, are come under pressure, or lawyers, because you have these new programs, they run through it, and at the end of the day, they sort of, do your books or give you a lot of advice, what the verdict or how you should put it, if you have a case. So it will go all across, it will basically affect every profession. which is pretty scary at the end of the day. I don't know if you read about Go. Did you read about Watson and Go? Go is I didn't know this game, but apparently Go is one of the most difficult games one can play. It's with these stones. I think it's played in Asia a lot and in Japan. So it's way more difficult than chess, to put it this way. And what happened is that Google invented a program which is self-learning. And in the beginning, this program played against a German, which is a bit like playing the German national football team against Monaco. Yeah, there is no Go scene in Germany. Okay, but this program was actually able to teach itself the sort of rules, and at the end of the day, this program won against the Asian champion 6 months down the line. And nobody thought that it's feasible anyway. So it is what it is at the end of the day. But there will be huge societal challenges. I do see that a lot of companies will be heavily impacted. I'll give you another example. Roughly 4 weeks ago, there was a press. There was an article about a Japanese insurance company. They laid off 30 people. It's not a lot, but they actually replaced it with Watson, the artificial intelligence system of IBM, and now Watson is sort of grading the insurance cases. I think, and I would absolutely agree with you, I think that actually India is in a way better position than other countries, because you are so technology driven. And it's a young nation, and you are ambitious. It will be way more difficult for the developed countries like Germany, Italy, France, you name it. Yeah? Because our population is aging. And with age, you're not as risk. Your risk appetite normally is not as much as when you're young, and we're also not that entrepreneurial. We were just lucky that after the Second World War, a lot of companies basically came again to Germany at the end of the day. You know what's very interesting? We, for instance, to give you an insight, and it's also public, it's also in the press. We, for instance, partner on the connectivity layer, which is the component technology. We basically partner with Cisco Jasper. And Cisco Jasper has a platform which is connected to 7,000 companies in the world. And they work together with 33 operators around the world. And what happened is that a lot of operators like Deutsche Telekom, Vodafone and others, they developed their own platform because especially here on the tech, on the systems design side, it's all about technology. And every company now wants to have the dominating platform. Yeah, they want to basically play it as Cisco Jasper because it's like a network effect now. Yeah? If Tesla wants to come to India, they are already on Cisco on the Cisco Jasper platform. Of course, they want to partner with us. Yeah, you don't go to a different platform because you won't have the functionality. And that's the reason, you know, why, for instance, Nokia, out of the blue, is also presenting an IoT platform. Yeah, everybody is very keen, you know, to basically mimic the Google, Apple, you name it, effect, but there are very few companies at the moment. So, to your questions, I would say the weakest slash and all the strongest part is the whole platform part. With the component technologies, with the sensors, that's something, you know, I mean, new sensors are being developed, but we're just talking about the devices. Yeah, and the most difficult part, of course, is then you have the applications running on top of it, and this will be more or less extremely driven by the country, what applications do we need, and by the industry vertical. I'll give an example. What we find out if we work with OEMs, with automakers, they only want to have connectivity. They don't want to have an application, and they don't want to have analytics because they don't want us, you know, to look at their analytics part. So they're just coming and saying to us, we want to have the connectivity, and that's about it. In other industries, it does vary. They say, okay, you know, we want an application, or with an application and the analytics. Yes? And that's where also, of course, you know, now a lot of data mining and digital agencies come into place because it's very interesting. What do you make out of the analytics? How do you go about that? At the end of the day, what IoT gives you in the first place is a stream of unstructured data. And then you have to make sense out of it. Do you know what the guy said from the University of London when somebody asked him what is big data? He said, big data is data you can't press in an Excel sheet any longer. That's big data. I think that's a very good definition of big data. Yeah. Any other questions? Thank you very much. It was a pleasure to be here.